Episode 2204, My Strength is My Story with Arden Bevere, Redefined.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at a stop
sign, watching people. Happy, happy day. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is my Strength is My Story series, and we have with us Arden Bevere. Yes, you know him as the youngest son of John and Lisa Bevere. We have an extraordinary conversation. It is jam-packed. I don't care what age you are. If you have young children, as in middle school and high school, have them listen to this. College students, listen to this. I'm telling you, if you're in your 80s, 90s, listen to this. It is inspiration. It's going to be motivation to your soul. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Arden's, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple strategy, everyday solutions to live, love, and impact. Well, I don't know about you, but we wear a lot of labels nowadays, and a lot of labels are put upon us. Arden dives deep into his brand new book, Redefined. And it's about time. It's a new year. It can be a new soul and spirit for you. Change the way you see things, the way you hear things, confronting the labels that limit you. Oh yes, it's time to be redefined. Without further ado, let's welcome in Arden Bevere. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I am so excited. We have within the house Arden Bevere. He is the husband of 2 years to his beautiful bride, Christian, and the youngest son of John and Lisa Bevere. Arden co-founded Sons and Daughters, a movement committed to raising up a generation of uncompromising followers of Christ who will transform our world. He has traveled the world doing ministry, speaking at conferences, and has a passion to see his generation go further than any that came before it, fully alive in this God adventure. Arden's latest adventure, though, is becoming an author of his brand new book, Redefined, Confronting the Labels That Limit Us. It's time to strip off what isn't yours. Welcome, my friend and brother in Christ. How are you, Arden?
I'm so good. Thank you so much for having me on. It's a huge honor. I'm excited to talk.
Well, it is an awesome book. You have an incredible story. Your journey is still just beginning. You're a young one. In fact, I don't want to necessarily announce it this way, but you're young enough, or I'm old enough to be your mother.
Yep, I am 26, so there's still a lot of growth that is happening inside of me.
Yes, and that's what's so exciting, especially about your book and what's coming in to your story and your journey. But before we jump into that, I've got to ask you, what brings you joy?
Ooh, what brings me joy? Well, my wife, for sure. I've been married for 2 years. We were talking about before, and it has been the best 2 years of my life. I actually I never knew there was so much joy. My parents always talked about it because my parents were newly Christians, newly saved, and they got married. And they were like, the first couple of years of our marriage was so terrible, so hard. You know, they had stories of throwing plates at each other and all that stuff. And I was like, I don't know what you guys are talking about. I was like, my marriage has been such a joy. So that's been incredible.
Well, that is fantastic because it is, you know, you're still early on, so you're newlywed, so congratulations. And I think you told me you have a little puppy dog, a fur child.
We do. We have I don't know. I mean, sometimes I call it a cat, but we have a little Yorkie that is, it's very adorable. I'm that like dad that, or, you know, dog dad that never really wanted a small dog, but then when he has a small dog, he like loves it to death. So That has been our journey with the dog.
Now, do you dress up the little puppy what happens with those? We get ribbons and hair dye?
Yeah, we did it once because we took her to the first time we took her to the groomer. She got completely shaved. They told us she was having such a hard time doing the haircut. So they just shaved her and she looked like a tiny rat. So my wife was like, it was during Christmas time. She was like, she can't look like this. We had her parents were actually coming into town and she was like, we have to get her something. So she dressed her up in this like holiday outfit that she wore for, you know, months until her hair grew back. So that's the only time we dressed her up. I think one time we dressed her up as a pumpkin for Halloween, but that was about it.
Oh, how adorable. Well, everybody has a bad haircut once in their life. So I guess for your little one, I guess it's time that she just start early.
Yeah, exactly. Oh.
Well, what was it like? You mentioned your mom and dad, and we know they are icons in the evangelical world, John and Lisa Bevere. What was it like growing up for little Arden?
Yeah, I mean, of course, as you know, that's a big part of my story. I think there was a lot of great things and a lot of, you know, difficult things. Growing up as John and Lisa Bevere's son, I remember people always asked me, "What is it like?" And I was like, honestly, I don't know anything different. My parents have been doing ministry since before I was born. They were full-time ministry, and that's what they occupied. And to me, them traveling all these days of the year was completely normal. I think the things that always presented challenges was the expectations from people. You know, I always had people that would have conversations with me and be like, "Are you the next John Bevere?" kind of thing. "Are you the next Lisa?" Like, you know, this big speaker and all this stuff. And for me, growing up, I never thought I would be in ministry. That was kind of the last thing all of us boys wanted to do. And ironically enough, we all are working for the ministry. But my parents did such a good job of never putting pressure on us to be like them. They actually always discouraged us to go into ministry. They said, "Hey, we want to make sure that you guys do whatever you feel like God's placed on your heart." They made us understand that ministry was not just an occupation, it was a lifestyle. And so they were like, you know, just because you don't go directly into occupational ministry doesn't mean you're not serving God and working in his kingdom. And so they would discourage it. And I remember when I was a kid, when people would ask me, you know, "Hey, are you the next John or Lisa Bevere?" That just caused me to sink into just such comparison of my parents, because I was like, I actually was in special needs reading and writing all the way through my freshman year of high school. And so the idea of writing a book or being a speaker or anything like that, or doing any kind of ministry in that capacity, I was like, that's the scariest thing in the world. There's no way I could ever do that. That's not even possible. And so that just kind of a little bit of what actually navigating. So the fact that this book, you know, one, I think I even told you before this that it took 5 years. I think the reason why it took 5 years is because the special needs part of me that had a little bit of a trouble with writing and getting it to that place, I really thought it was a good book. But, you know, it's honestly just such a testament to God's grace on my life.
Amen. And what he has done for you, stripping off those labels. And that's really what Redefined is all about. You write about living your faith on the coattails of your parents, like you just mentioned. In your personal discovery of who God is, where did God meet you?
Yeah. So I actually was the only son that walked away from Christ. All of my family, you know, just all my brothers, they faithfully served God throughout high school. You know, they all made their mistakes, of course, but I was the only one that was like, you know what? I know there's a God. I know Jesus died on the cross, but honestly, I just don't care. And I was in that like teenage stage where just hormones, everything was going on. And I handled it completely wrong. So I remember I walked away from Christ. I got big into partying, the drinking, girls, all those things. And for about 3 years, I was away from God. And I had grew up in, as we said, a Christian household. And I knew everything about the gospel. I knew all the things I was doing wrong. I knew all the things that I needed to be doing. And I remember I was in a church in San Diego. And back then, what I would do is my dad would make us travel with him. And I would always go and sit at the book table that was out in the lobby so I didn't have to be in the service. And at this specific church, it was a small church. And so the book table was actually in the auditorium. And I was like, well, I can't really escape it. I'll still sit at the book table, but I'm going to be in the service. And I remember I was sitting there in the service, you know, on my phone, and just God just began to highlight my dad to me. And as I was, he was just kind of there preaching. I don't even remember what message he was talking on. I don't remember what he was saying. And I just remember, I felt like I just was seeing the light of God coming from my dad. And I remember I heard the voice of God saying, "What are you doing?" And some people get saved by, you know, the love of God. I had experienced the love of God as a kid growing up, but this was the fear of God that hit me. And it was this fear of God that hit me in that moment that completely shifted my life. I remember I did a full 180 that day. I went home. I broke up with this girl that I was dating that was non-Christian, which I'll just emphasize, my parents would have never let me date a non-Christian. I went through a long, like, 6-month period of time trying to convince them to let me date them, saying, you know, hey, I'm 17. I know all the things I need to know, kind of thing. Like, I'm mature, which that was a complete lie. And I just went through that season and I completely 180'd it. And so I remember God met me there. And I want to make sure I emphasize this the correct way, is that the fear of God was not being afraid of God. I think the fear of God is so beautifully highlighted. It's actually talked about in the Bible as the fear of God is the word into me in the Hebrew. And that means into intimacy, a deeper level of intimacy. And the fear of God was not being afraid of God. It's being afraid of being away from him. And so he hit me there, and that was absolutely incredible. And God actually completely flipped my life, which was amazing, and then actually used me to be able to reach all of those friends that were going to the parties and going out and were just as lost as me. And I remember God had told me, he said, you know, hey, take a year, stay away from alcohol, stay away from all the stuff, just spend time in my word. And so instead of going out, I would do that. And then he said, okay, now you can go back to those parties. And I was like, are you sure? And he's like, yes, those people were you. They're broken, they're lost, they're all those things. And so I remember I started going back to those parties, and I mean, without fail, every single party I went to, God created some kind of opportunity for me to be able to share about him. I remember one party I had about 15 people down in the basement that was just telling them about the gospel. Because, you know, when you get a little bit tipsy, you start like having the greatest life questions of like, why am I here and things like that. So I was like, great, I am going to be right there and I'm going to tell them why they're here and all those things. And I was like, I'll clean up their throw up. I'll encourage them. I'll support them. And I'll just be there. So it's been amazing how God impacted me in that way and just shifted everything so quick.
Oh, God is so good. And what a breath of fresh air for your parents. Because I know they're looking going, oh, Lord, we can't do this anymore. I mean, that would be the mother of me talking, you know. It'd be like, oh, Lord, you've got to take Arden under your wing. You got him. And he did. It's amazing when we need God most and we stop long enough, he shows up bigger than ever, exactly how we need to see him. Words have power. Obviously, you were touched at that time when you did a full 180. One of the first things you write in your book is the question you posted on your Facebook page. If you could describe the young adult generation today in one word, what would it be? What did these answers spark in you?
Yeah, that was the whole start of this book. My brother had asked me just to target our generation kind of better. Like he said, how can we more specifically reach the younger generation? And I remember I started writing out some things that I thought about our generation. And I was like, well, we're creative, we're innovative, we're pioneers, we're all these things and all positive stuff. And so I posed that question thinking I was going to get a bunch of great answers that were going to help me on this quest. And as I saw all those answers flood in, and I mean, they came so rapid. They were all things that were like broken, entitled, lacking, and addicted, fearful, disillusioned, discouraged, all these things that were not just from, you know, the older generation people, because I was like, yeah, you know, I get it. Some of the older generation looks at our generation kind of like, you guys got some things to work on. But I was like, it was actually from people that were in my generation. And my heart was breaking to see that we were beginning to believe the labels that were spoken over us. And as I was sitting there watching all of these things come in, I remember God began to give me scripture that was counteracting all of those negative labels that were being put over our generation. And I remember the first scripture he gave me was the scripture in 1 Peter 2, verse 9. And it talks about, it says, but you are not those people. And I loved it because that very translation I looked up, it said specifically, but you are not those people. It says, but you are a chosen priesthood, a royal nation. And so I just remember I said, God, your view of us is so much greater. And so as I begin to understand this, what I did was God told me, this was never supposed to be a book. He told me, he said, I want you to take these words that are being written on this Facebook page, and I want you to make them your prayer for this generation. And so I took all those words and I started just journaling them. And I would journal them and I would break down why maybe the world had saw our generation in this way. And then I would go into scripture and I would research and I would discover what God is calling this generation to. And I would write it down and I would make that my prayer for our generation. I think the beautiful thing that I found out while doing this is that God does not label us. He calls us. You know, a label speaks to the here and now, or the then and now. And it speaks to who we are right now or who we have been in the past. It does not go beyond what is natural. And that's what the world can do, because that's all they can see. They can only see the here and then. And that's not how God calls us. God speaks to the eternity that he's placed on our heart, the potential he has inside of us. I remember what my parents used to do. And I mean, I'd encourage this for parents, if there's parents listening, but what my parents used to do when we were kids, we hated so much. And it didn't make sense to us then, but it makes sense to us now. But they used to call us princes. And they would be like, whenever we acted out, whenever we did something wrong, whenever we talked back to them, they'd be like, no, you're a prince. Like, prince don't act like that. And I'm like, Mom, do you have some like royal inheritance that we don't know about? Or are we like, we're not the latest Disney prince that you see on TV. And what they were doing is that they were speaking to the identity that we had on our life. And it was not because we were Beveres. It was not because we were some special family or anything like that. It was because we were sons and daughters of God and the inheritance that we had on our life. So when we were kids, we didn't understand that. But as we grew up, we began to walk in those labels, walk in those callings that God had for us into the inheritance as we grew in a better understanding of what he had for us as sons and daughters of God. And so that's what I'm wanting to see from our generation, is that we don't live by the labels that the world puts on us. And I think, you know, that's the tricky thing, is we have a lot of people that don't know how to get past those labels. And that's what I tried to do with this book, is show the importance of God's word, because I do think we have generation right now has so much information, and we're lacking a ton of transformation. And transformation comes from the word of God. It does not come from the latest podcast, the latest, you know, message, or your favorite preacher's Instagram posts. It comes from the word of God. And I think we have a generation right now that does not know what the word of God is saying over them.
Oh, that is so true. And I, as you're talking, I'm sitting there, amen, praise the Lord, preach it, brother. I mean, we need to hear more of this. In fact, to the point where, what do we have to lose if we choose to own the labels placed upon us?
Yeah. What do we have to lose? I mean, we have to lose our inheritance. Like, that's the thing I think is really what I want to see from this generation. And what I even talk about at the end of the book is I want our generation to be known as sons and daughters of God. And I think, and this might be a little countercultural, but I think the problem in the world is not a lack of sons and daughters of God. So in other words, a lack of converts. I think the problem in the world is a lack of sons and daughters of God who have stepped into the fullness of what that means. Because then you would see the transformation of this world. You would see the more converts that are coming to Christ. You would see more disciples being made. You know, I look at what just 12 disciples were able to do, the lineage of what they've been able to do, how the gospel continues to carry on, because they were on fire and understanding what they had been given inside of them, and they were on this mission. And so I think right now what we're seeing is we're seeing a lot of people that are kind of a figurehead, you know, in the kingdom, where they are just like, yeah, we're saved, we're son or daughter of God. And when you're just a figurehead, all you are is just standing in a place. And when you don't fully understand what God's given you and the power he's given you, like, there's so much power. I love the story, that one of my favorite stories is found in, it's Romans 22. It's the story of Paul's citizenship. And I remember when I was reading through this the first time, God just highlighted it to me in such a unique way. And it was Paul going through his citizenship, and he was about to be flogged by a Roman officer. And he's about to go through this very painful experience. And Paul looks at the Roman officer and he says, what right do you have? In other words, or he says, is it lawful? In other words, what right do you have? And he said, for I am a Roman. And see, Paul understood the power that came with being a Roman. And if he understood how much power came with being a Roman, how much more power comes with us being citizens of the kingdom of heaven? And I love it, because the one translation, actually the message paraphrase, says that the fear of God hit the Roman officer. And he backed up off of Paul, and he said, he went to his superior officer and he said, hey, this man is a Roman. And a superior officer came to Paul and he said, hey, with a great deal of money, I have paid for my citizenship. In other words, what did you do, Paul? And Paul just simply says, but I was born a Roman. And so I think that's what we've got to understand, is that you may not have been born into a Christian household or born into a Christian family, but when you were born again, you were born into the kingdom of heaven, which gives you this new identity, gives you a new inheritance, and a new ability to step into all that God has for you. But if we don't know what his word says, we don't know everything that he has for us.
That's so good. We need that intimacy, and we're missing that. It's like we want to wear the hat. We want to place the label on us. Hey, I'm Christian. Look at me. I'm good. I don't have to do anything more. But there's so much more to being a citizen in God's kingdom, to be a prince and a princess. And, you know, I think sometimes our fleshly being, our earthly perspective, has a hard time of wrapping it around God's perspective, the heavenly perspective. How did you begin to remove those labels on you?
Yeah, well, that's the thing is a lot of these chapters, every single one of these chapters, I only picked the words for this book out of all the ones that I grabbed that I had personally gone through. And so every single one was always something, you know, different. And I remember the story that spoke the most to me in the Bible as I was kind of learning how to navigate this ability to be over to overcome the labels was the story of Jesus in the wilderness. You know, Jesus is out there in the wilderness. He spends 40 days out there in the wilderness and the enemy comes to tempt him. And I thought it was so interesting that the enemy comes to tempt him, but before he tempts him, he questions who he is. He says, if you are truly the Son of God, then you would be able to do this. And Jesus doesn't look back at the enemy and says, you know, hey, I know I'm the Son of God. And the enemy knew exactly who Christ was. He was with Christ. He was with the Word before the foundations of the world. But yet the enemy still wanted to try to get Jesus to feel insecure and try to make some, you know, some cheap display of power in order to prove who he was. And I love that Jesus doesn't respond in this like, you know, hey, the prophet said this or something like this. No, Jesus simply just recites back to him the word of God. And my parents taught me so much as I was growing up, how much power the word has over you. And not just to get stuff like, you know, hey, I got this one thing and then that's it. Like I spend 10 minutes in the word and then I spend, you know, 2 hours on social media or 2 hours listening to the news. They said, no, you want to make sure you're balanced in your life. Because the word of God is what's going to speak the life and going to keep you true. I love the quote. It says, the only thing that you have to do to drift is nothing. And I think we have a lot of people that are drifting away from what the word of God says about them because we are not getting into it. And I love what Jesus exemplified and showed there is that he showed, hey, it's not this great, you know, great understanding that I had. It was the word of God, the thing that you have in your life. And so when I navigated a lot of those seasons, I mean, every single chapter, I showed my personal experience, the things that God showed me. And then I showed the scriptures that helped me, the scriptures that showed me, you know, hey, how do I get through this? Or give me an example of someone that navigated something similar. I think that's a huge thing is I think all people always say, you know, personal experience is the best teacher. And I say, no, it's not. I think other people's experience is the best teacher because if I'm driving down the road and I get pulled over, I wish someone else would have gotten pulled over and I would have saw it and just learned from it. But the word of God is other people's experiences. And we have an opportunity so great and so amazing that we get to literally read these people's experiences, learn and grow from them so that we can go further and further. I think that's why God even said that the Latter-day Church is going to be greater than former, because he wanted to see the Latter-day Church learn and stand on what the things the former had grown and taught and struggled with and learned from so that we can do things even better. I mean, that's what my parents always taught us. They said, you know, hey, we hope our hope and dreams is that you boys would go further than any of us will. And they said, because we want you to make sure that you learn from our mistakes, that our mistakes are not in vain, that our mistakes were not just for no reason. So, you know, that's what I'm wanting to see from my generation. It's just that we be a people that are so immersed in the word of God that when a label does come against us, it has no place to take root. I think even with the chapter that I talk about of doubt, you know, I talk about it with my dad and I'm like, you know, hey, here's the thing. If someone came to me and they said something that was contradictory, I have a close relationship with my dad, and they said something that was contradictory to me about my dad, it would have zero place to take ground because I know my dad so well. I know his character. I know his things that he does. I know his routines, all that stuff. But I think we have a lot of people that they don't have that close intimacy with the word of God and with God. And so when they hear things that are contrary to the word of God or contrary to God's character, they're so quick to allow it to take root in their life.
Oh, that's so good. Well, you mentioned doubt, and that's a big label. You started preaching at an early age. I believe the first sermon you preached was on doubt. I think it was 18. And in the book, though, you write, doubt is a clear indicator that God is setting us up for growth, and how we respond to doubt makes all the difference. How can we respond to doubt in a way that propels us forward and doesn't hold us back?
Yeah, that's great. I grew up and we traveled to a lot of different circles and a lot of different churches. And I grew up with this understanding, and a lot of people had told us that, hey, if you're experiencing doubt, it means that you have weak faith and that you just need to have faith and not doubt. And I was always frustrated with that because I felt like it was just trying to pushing things down. And so I discovered at a young age this idea of doubt because I went through a season where I lost multiple friends. I lost one to suicide, one went to jail, and then I had another one actually got ran over by a train. And so it was just a terrible season for my life. And I remember that was actually right after I came back to Christ, and I struggled with some questions. And I said, God, what is going on? I said, you promise all these things, that you love me so much. How could all these things be going on in my life? And it really caused me to come face to face with God. And I had this question in my life of, I can either run from all these doubts or I can run to God and get the answers. And I think that's the problem that I've been seeing with a lot of even my friends and people in this generation is we go off and we maybe, let's say, we experience some doubts from college professors. We experience some doubts from friends, like things that are new ideas that are proposed into our minds. And rather than actually going to God and figuring out the questions, we just draw back. And I think the problem is doubt is a dangerous thing when it becomes the end of your journey. If you stop at your doubt and just say, you know what, God, I don't think you're big enough to answer my question. I remember one time I was at Bible college and one of my professors said, you know, hey, if you have a hard question about God, he said, write it on a piece of paper, crumble it up and throw it into the fire. And I was like, no, I said, that's absolutely wrong. I said, you're saying that God's not big enough to answer the questions that you have. I said, I believe my God is that. And I remember during that time, God showed me the story of Job. And this was the first time I read through the story of Job. And I remember after that, I even told someone, I was like, yeah, my favorite book in the Bible is Job. They're like, man, you're such a Bevere. They're like, that's like, no one likes Job. And I was like, what was a big foundational book for me during that time? And I remember because Job starts off his life, you know, for people who don't know, Job loses everything. He loses his family. He loses all of his livestock. He loses his health, all within a matter of time. And it wasn't because he had done anything wrong. It was because he was actually so righteous that God said, I don't believe that Job will ever, you know, will ever go against me. And so he allowed the enemy attack Job. And you see Job's response in the beginning of the book where he kind of has that, you know, hey, just believe kind of response. And he says, you know, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh. And he just kind of pushed it down. But you see that he begins to have the wrong conversations with his friends. He begins to have these conversations and they start blaming him. I mean, his wife gets to the point where she's like, you should just curse God and die. Like, that's a terrible place to be. And he begins to have these wrong conversations and you see this doubt that starts to well up in him. And finally, he does the right thing and he goes to God. And I love this expression that God has for him. And God shows up to Job in this grand storm. And I think before, Job had lived off of God by rumors and all these things. But yet when Job took his doubts to God, he was able to experience the creator of the universe. And God opens up and he is talking to Job through a violent storm. And he begins to share to him all of the amazing mysteries of the universe. He says, where were you when I did this? Where were you when I did this? Where were you when I did this? All these things. And Job just is, you know, he has this response. He says, I'm speechless. And he said, never again will I live off of rumors of you again. And I think that's what we have to do is that when we have a period of doubt, that if we just allow it to be the end, we are actually missing out on a greater expression of God that we have yet to discover. You know, I love Charles Spurgeon. He talked about it. He said, if a man says he never doubts, he said, I think it's about time that we begin to start doubting him. And he said, I think it's about time we say, you're not even on a path at all. And he said, as you discover, as you start going on this journey of this Christian walk, he said, there's going to be greater things that you discover. There's going to be new things that you discover, which will open up the ideas for doubt. But you cannot have faith without doubt. And the faith is something that is so beautiful, but we have the ability to be able to go to God and say, hey, God, I'm putting my faith in you that you would discover and you would show me new facets of you. And so that's just something, you know, I had to navigate and I had to learn. And I watched this every single time. And since then, every single time I had, even recently when I was experiencing doubt, every time I go to God, he shows me a new wonder and a new expression of him that I've never seen before.
Well, that's amazing for you even to put it in words, that if doubt becomes the end of your journey, I mean, that's kind of a firestorm there in itself. Yeah. Because you're saying, okay, that's it. For the person who might be on the edge and is discouraged, really just feeling lost and broken, what encouragement would you give them right now?
Yeah, I think on, if you're right on the edge, I love that God is a God that uses those things that you feel like are no longer usable. He uses all those things that are broken. You know, I think that's the beautiful expression of God. And I think, you know, you look at Thomas, if it's navigating doubt, like Thomas was at the end of his journey, it felt like. He said, you know, we know him as Doubting Thomas. He's got that bad rep. But if you actually know the rest of Thomas's story, is after he has that experience with Jesus, when he said, no, I need to actually see him. And Jesus appears to him. He said, hey, look, here. And Thomas got to see, you know, again, Thomas got, knew Jesus as friend, as teacher, and all these things. But then Thomas got to see the manifestation of Christ right before him. And he got to experience Christ in a new way that none of the other disciples were able to see. And I love Thomas's story because it didn't end there. He actually goes on and he impacts India in a massive way for Christ. I mean, just a crazy, crazy way. And then he ends up dying a martyr for his faith. And so the person that he once doubted, he then died, gave his whole life for in India. And so I think for people that are navigating this time of just brokenness and time of hurting, you know, 2020 did a lot of that for a lot of people. And as we were kind of in that last straw, just understanding that if you allow that to be the end of your story, that's all it's going to be. But God is the God that restores everything. He always wants to use your trauma, your pain, your hurt, everything that you've gone through for good. He never wants to waste those things. Those things are never going to be hidden from your life. You know, I think that's the beautiful thing of what God does is part of our testimony. The Bible talks about, you know, that we overcome by the word of by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony. Is our testimony is not eradicated. It's actually highlighted. And it shows that, you know, God was able to do such an amazing work through this. And because of that, he can do an amazing work in other people's lives. And so I would just encourage you that if you are feeling like on that place of you know, brokenness and all those things, just continue to cry out to God. You know, one of my favorite stories, I'll say this really quick, but one of my favorite stories is the story of Hannah in the Bible. And Hannah was in this place of brokenness. God had closed her womb. Hannah was going through this process where she's crying out for a son. And you find a story in 1 Samuel, and she's crying out for a son. And the Bible says God had closed her womb. She gets to that point of desperation. And she begins to find her answer in the presence of man, and she just continues to seek deeper and deeper in despair. And that's what I would encourage you with, is you're not going to find your answers in the presence of man. You're only going to be able to find it in the presence of God. Because she finds out, she goes deeper and deeper in despair, and then she runs to God, and she goes to the temple, and she cries out so violently to God that the, you know, Eli, the priest at the time, he thinks she's drunk. And he said, you need to go home. He said, you can't be drunk here. And she said, no, I'm not drunk. I'm a woman that's hard to use, crying out to my God. And he said, whatever you are praying for God, he said, may it be granted to you. And I think that's the beautiful thing about her story, is the whole time she was thinking that she just wanted one son. She was like, just give me one son, God. But the entire time that she was praying and crying out, she was not just fighting for one son. She was fighting for six children. She was able to get six kids. And her first son was Samuel, the one who went and anointed the king of Israel. And so I think what happens is when we are feeling this discouragement and these troubles and these hard times, it's because God actually has so much more in store for you. And you feel like, hey, I'm fighting this battle. And God said, no, you're actually fighting for so much more. So keep crying out, because here's the thing. You never have to lose the battle. God's promise is that you never have to lose. So you have to just keep crying out, keep going to him, keep being desperate for the things of God, and God will bring a restoration in the most unlikely time. I mean, who would have thought that Eli would have been the one that would have anointed her and said, like, yes, you know, whatever God says or whatever you're praying to God, make it happen. So I think we just need to be continuing to go to God in that desperation moment.
Well, y'all are going to want to pick up your own copy of Redefined, Confronting the Labels That Limit Us. Well, you also talk about some very important information in your book, and it kind of leads us to social media and all things that breed comparison and pride. And we could be here for hours upon hours on this topic alone, but you write, when you constantly compare ourselves to others, we lose confidence in who we are. Comparison causes us to forget or despise the special things God has placed in us. How do you create those boundaries that keep you grounded to what God sees and not how you see yourself and what other people say?
Yeah. Well, I think I remember I had this discovery in God last year. He told me, he said, Arden, I am an infinite God, which means I have infinite attributes about me. And he said, if all of my children are created uniquely, he said, that means that there is an expression of me and my sons and daughters of God that is a unique expression that the world has never seen. And he said, within every single person that, you know, is a child of God, there is something that is waiting to be seen by the world. And I think what social media has done such a disservice to our generation is we spend so much time looking at all the things that other people have. And it's honestly, like we've heard so many times, it's just people's highlights reels. That's all it is. And so you're comparing all the negative things about yourself. I remember this was kind of just weird, but my mom used to get mad at us boys whenever we'd be like, oh, we don't like our nose, or we don't like our, you know, like our teeth and stuff. She'd get mad at us and she's like, hey, that's my nose. Like, that's the nose I gave you kind of thing. And she's like, how dare you insult that, because you're insulting me. And that kind of made me think, well, you know, it's the same for our creator. Is we think, you know, God, I don't like the way that you made me. Maybe I'm not super talented in this area. Maybe I have this weird, you call it weird, but God might call it absolutely beautiful, but weird thing about you that you don't like. And God said, well, that's actually something I gave you personally. That's straight from me. And he said, that's something that I want to show beauty to this world in. It's such a creative and new expression. And so I think for us, we have to not see these things as weaknesses. I love what the Bible shows is the world that we live in. So it basically just tells us, you know, hey, we need to hide all of our weaknesses and we need to show our strengths. And that's it. But we serve a God that says, show me your weakness and I will make you strong. Show me those areas that you don't feel confident in, all those things, and I am going to prove my faithfulness in those areas. So we have to be a generation that looks at that, looks at the inside of us and say, you know what, there is something inside of me that God's placed in there that is so unique that this world needs to see, so that they can see in a greater expression of God that is waiting to be unfolded, and not compare to anything else, because you'll take your eyes off of what's special about you and focus on others.
Oh, that's so good, Arden. I just think when you said that, I was like, God need to make me taller. And we still have a discussion once in a while. I'm getting easier, letting him off the hook a little bit, going, I know you gave me that, because if he gave me that, guess what? I wouldn't have something else. Because this is who he created me to be. And it's hard for us to sometimes come to grip with that. But we're not perfect until we're called home. And we are being groomed here on earth to become who he wants us to be when we go home and when we show up at his feet. We talked about fear earlier, and there's so many things in your book. In fact, there's 10 things you go through, and I just want to highlight them so people know, because I really do believe not just your generation, but anybody's age, as long as they can read, will benefit from this book. So you highlight 10 of them: lost, broken, doubtful, regretful, offended, lacking, addicted, discouraged, entitled, and fearful. One thing I want to talk about, which you mentioned before and hit on, a lot of people struggle with fear.
Yeah.
How do you personally define fear?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think the greatest way that we've got to understand this is that there's two fears that are talked about in the Bible. And I think what I've seen a lot from our generation is we've clumped in both of the fears all into one thing. And we say, when we comes to, you know, our understanding of the fear of God, we're like, well, no, there's no fear in my relationship with God. The Bible says perfect love casts out all fear. There's no room for fear in my relationship with God. I don't fear God. And that is completely wrong, because Exodus 20:20, I love this verse, and it would be really confusing if there was only one fear. But Moses says to the people, he said, do not fear, for God has come to see that his fear is inside, is within you, so that you may not sin. And that would be really confusing if it was only one fear. Like, do not fear so that God has come to test that his fear is inside you. He's like, no, that doesn't make sense. And it's because there's two types of fears. There's worldly fear And then there's a godly fear. And the thing that we've got to understand as a generation is God has called us to live without the fear of man. I remember when I was a kid, I was told of the first time I really heard God's voice, I was in middle school, and I grew up with this understanding. I was like, I can't let people know I'm a Christian. I went to public schools and I was like, they just shame Christians. And I was like, I can't let them know. And I mean, that was really hard for someone that their parents literally made, their whole life was around the gospel and all that stuff. And so I remember people would ask me, they were like, hey, what are your parents doing? I'm like, oh, they're authors. And they're like, well, what books have they written? And I'm like, stuff on personal growth. Like, they're like, what's the title? And I'm like, I'm going to stay away from Thus Saith the Lord or Beta Satan or things like that. And by that time, they would normally get it. But I had this fear of what people expected and thought about me. And I remember God spoke to me this one time in Bible study, and it was absolutely incredible. He told me that I opened up my Bible and I read the story about the farmer going out and sowing a seed. And I was like, I'm supposed to go out and I'm supposed to just sow seed throughout my school. And I said, some of it's going to get hated on, all this stuff. And I said, I just know I'm supposed to do it. And I remember I came to school the next day. The reality of that actually hit me. And I completely folded to the fear of man. And that's the thing that God does not want us to have, is there cannot be any room for the fear of man, because whatever you fear will become your master. If you fear God, then you'll live according to his word. But if you fear man, then you'll live under the opinion of man. You'll live with that being the dictator of your life. And I love it because, as I said about fear earlier, is fear is a greater depth of intimacy. And you can see throughout the Bible, there's examples of people that used the fear of God in such a beautiful way. Like Solomon wrote about it. He talked about it. He said the beginning of wisdom is the fear of God. What is wisdom? Wisdom is taking knowledge and turning it into action. And we have a generation that has a lot of knowledge, as I said before, but we've yet to take it and turn it into action. And so I love that he said that the beginning of wisdom is the fear of God. The fear of God keeps us amongst his commandments. It makes us understand that the world's challenges and presence and all those things is nothing compared to God. I love one of the quotes I actually shared in the book. Is a quote. It just absolutely beautifully illustrates this. And he talks about how he said that we've done such a disservice to God, and we think that the whole thing of that God needs to do is to balance out the stresses of the world. And he said, when we do that, he said, we actually reduce God's to the world's equal. And he said, how much different is this than what scripture shows, where God is far scarier than the world? He said, if we do this, we give the world unwarranted power. And I think that's what I've seen a lot from this generation, is we have so many different fears. We have fears of, not making a difference, fears of coworkers, fears of friends, fears of parents, fears of things that we just don't want to fear of failure, things we don't want to step out on. And God's saying, look, if you can just fear me, he said, you'll learn how to live fearlessly. And I love it. Abraham was a friend of God. I mean, he was absolutely, that's how we define him. We're like, Abraham, the friend of God. We learn that in our, on our children's stories and things like that. And Abraham gets this commandment from God to go kill his son, to sacrifice his son, Isaac. And Abraham, I love his diligence towards God, because it says the very next morning he's up and going, and he goes to the mountain the very next morning. And Hebrews talks about it. And Hebrews says that through that whole journey, Abraham dared to believe that God would resurrect Isaac from the dead. That even though Abraham knew up until that point, no one had been resurrected from the dead. And so Abraham thought to himself, he dared to believe that God would do something so impossible, so out of his comprehension. He still believed that God would do it, because he feared God so much, and he wanted to obey God so much, that he knew, hey, even if I obey God to completion, God's going to make the impossible happen in my life. And I love it, because he gets to that point where he's about to sacrifice Isaac, and the angel appears to Abraham, and the angel says to Abraham, he says, now that I know that you fear God. And I think it's so important right now that we have the fear of God right now, because Isaiah says, the fear of God does not judge by the seeing of the eye or the hearing of the ear. It judges by righteous judgment. And we have a lot of people that are seeing all the things that are going on in this world, and we're hearing all the things that are going wrong in the world, and we're making judgment based off of that, where the fear of God does not make judgment based off of that. It makes it based off of what the word of God says, the holding true to his commandments, and what the Lord Jesus has to say about this world. So I think I want to see more than ever. And this is something we just don't talk about. Besides my dad and my older brother, I don't think I've ever heard a preacher talk about the fear of God. Because that's not a very attractive subject. It's like, no, like if you heard that, like, hey, we're going to talk about fearing God today. It's like, what? No, kind of thing. But I think it's one of the most important things our generation needs to grab hold of.
I totally agree with you. And it's not just your generation. It's across the board. We have gotten so relaxed in our being and expressing ourselves as Christians. Sometimes I think we don't even know what we don't know or what we know what we don't know what we know. I mean, it can be so like discombobled in our own mind that you're like, yeah, I kind of heard it. Maybe the last time I heard it was when I was a child. And we don't get the real application of what it means to embody and fear God. What does that mean? And I love that you bring that in your book, Redefined. And we need to be talking about these tough things, especially during our time.
And I will say, because, you know, Romans 3 talks about it, and it says our chief sin is that we have no fear. So our chief sin, the thing that boils down to everything else, the number one sin, it says that we have no fear of God at all. And I think that's really important when we understand, like, how do I navigate this? How do I stay clear from sin and all this stuff? How do I live righteously unto God? And I think, you know, maybe too, why we don't talk about it a ton is that back then there was a lot of and my dad tells us about this. He says, you know, and he even said, look, there was a time where I went to a meeting, and he said, I had heard from different people that he said that John Bevere doesn't steward the sheep. He, you know, like whips the sheep kind of thing. Like he just attacks the sheep. And he said, it hurt me so bad. He said, made me understand the greater fear of God that I needed to have in my life and making sure I was not preaching harshly, but I had this love and compassion towards people. And I think that's the thing, is that we had a lot of preachers that were using the fear of God to try to control people. And so I think we tried to go completely away from it, and we shied away from it, and we missed out on that. And I think that's what the enemy does try to do. He tries to get this beautiful expression of what God is, and he gets people to misuse it and, you know, really hurt people in that process. And so we want to stay as far away from that thing, even though it's something so great for us.
I totally agree. And we've got to be very careful. And that means that we have to own our relationship with God. There is no preacher that can sit here or anybody that can influence your relationship with your God if you are intimate with him and you come to knowing him. And that is getting back to what you're talking about, is getting back in the word, knowing him intimately and having that relationship. One of the things, Arden, that the words that popped up, I know if I was asked your question, I showed up on your Facebook page, entitlement would have come. I think probably that might have been the number one word. I have no idea if you actually took a tally as to who repeated the words. In your book, you talk about how you deal with entitlement. And I really grabbed onto that one because I have my children. I have quite the span of them from 25 now to 16. And so I have multi-generations, plus I have a grandchild. So my family is growing and expanding. The generations that I influence now directly to me are bigger. When you answered this in your book, I was like, oh yeah, we need this. How do you answer entitlement?
Yeah, well, I mean, I say the word that I know God's speaking over us is gratitude. You know, I remember I went through a season of entitlement. I came back from an internship, and I had, you know, multiple words spoken over me that I was, you know, going to do great things in ministry and all that stuff. And I came back and I said, well, mom and dad, these people spoke these words over me. You guys said you wanted us to go further and farther than you guys. So it's your job to make those things happen. Like, you need to create more opportunities, all this stuff. And I navigated this long season where I was a terror to work with. It was absolutely, I hated that season for myself. I felt so bad for the people looking back on it, because, you know, I felt like, you know, hey, I'm not making a difference doing my day-to-day job here at, you know, my 8-to-5 job here. And so I would just not show up for work sometimes. I would respond rudely to emails, all that stuff. And I was dealing with this entitlement because I felt like God had a place, such a gift on my life to do something. And because it wasn't being happened, I deserved more. And that was completely wrong. And I remember I figured out kind of a year later that I needed to go work on myself. And so I went back to Bible college, and I just told myself, I said, God, I want to serve and I want to know you better. And so I remember that's all I did that whole year is I served at the church I was at. And then I also just spent all my time in his word and just learning and just kind of diving deep into all that he had for me. And so during that year, God just had showed me all the incredible things that were actually happening. And I remember feeling so just ashamed of just how I had tried to push my own agenda while God was already doing so much incredible stuff that I could have been a part of. And I had this phone call with my mom and I said, hey, mom, I think I'm supposed to come back after this year. And she said, no, you can't come back. She said, you know, nothing's changed. She said, there's no new opportunities. There's no new roles. There's nothing. And I said, mom, I know that nothing has changed. And I said, but there has been one thing that's changed, and that's me. And I said, that was the only thing that needed to change. And I remember I came back with this just gratitude and understanding of just thankfulness that I knew God had my life in control and that I just needed to stand in this thankfulness and teachability for all of the days of my life. I told my dad recently, I said, there's only two things I think you need to be successful in life. And I said, one is teachability and two is the fear of God. And I said, I think if you have that, then you can always grow. You can always stay true, close to God. And so I remember I came back and my parents actually, they said, hey, we can't hire you. Like people on the staff do not want to work with you. They said, they knew all the stories. You were a terror the first time. We can't hire you. And I said, that's great. I'll come and serve. I was like, I'm so thankful to be in this family and so thankful for all this. I remember I served for about 3 months just at the ministry with nothing, no pay, nothing like that. And then they were like, well, we want to bring you on this part-time role. And it was doing the exact same thing that I was doing before. And so I was getting paid only part-time for this time rather than full-time. And I just never felt so fulfilled. And I watched as I just continue to serve and as I continue to have this attitude of thankfulness that God just began to open up more and more doors. And I think, you know, there's that process that has to happen in every single one of us. And our generation hates process because we are so about instantaneous stuff. You know, if we're hungry, we get on our phone and order Uber Eats. If we want to send a text message to someone, like we get it immediately. We didn't have those days of no text messaging and all that stuff. And we want things to happen so instantaneous, but there's so much power that comes in the process that we can't act entitled. We can't act like we're trying to shove out the older generation. I think we do such a massive disservice to ourselves when we try to push out the older generation. I think we miss out on all of the experience, the lessons, the blessings that come from them. And that's been something I even told my dad. Up until just a couple weeks ago or a couple months ago, I always would do my dad's vitamins and people at the ministry would come by and they'd be like, what are you doing? Like you need to, like, you're running sons and daughters. You're traveling, you're doing all this stuff. And I was like, no, I'm not going to stop doing this because I said, it helps me just feel like I can continue to keep serving my dad in this capacity. And I want to do that. And I remember I told my dad, I said, Dad, I want to make sure that your years of from 60 to 70 are going to be the most impactful years of ministry of your life. And so I just came to this understanding of as I serve and as I come and accept this gratitude and not trying to take things for myself, but I accept God's timing, that God elevates you in his timing. You come when you're elevated in God's timing, you are elevated with his blessing. When you try to do it to yourself, like when you try to take things, you actually, like, I love the story of Ahab. King Ahab, he wants this vineyard that is in his kingdom. That's one of the beautiful vineyard. And he goes through this process where he's like, hey, can I have this vineyard, to the guy? And the guy said, no, it's been in my family for all these years. And he goes and throws a fit. Like he just goes, runs into his room and, you know, goes on his bed, starts crying, all this stuff. And Jezebel comes to him and she said, what are you doing? You're the king of Israel. Why are you acting like this? And he said, well, he doesn't give me his vineyard. And she's like, well, I'll take care of it. And she sends out a letter that goes and gets the man killed. And she says that man was saying bad things about God, the God of Israel, and saying bad things about the king. And that man's stoned. And I remember Ahab, she comes back to Ahab and she said, Ahab, the vineyard's yours, go claim it. And Ahab goes and claims it. And the prophet comes to Ahab and he says, hey, where this man has died, he said, you basically just killed yourself. He said, you will die in this exact same spot. And I think that's the interesting thing is that when we try to push things out of our own timing, out of entitlement and out of not gratitude, something in our life has to die. And that could be a loss of, that could be a death to trust, that could be a death in relationship, a death in a dream, a death in anything. And I think that's important for us as we lean into God's timing. It opens up the door for life. But if we try to force things on our own time and entitlement, it leads to death.
Thank you, Arden, for sharing and just being vulnerable with just, I mean, literally saying, this is what it was for me. We don't have that anymore. There's almost not truth, right? I mean, you and I believe the truth is the Bible. But we've got so many lies that are being told out there, spoken over us, that we have now inhabited that. And so for you to come out and share your intimate stories as to how in your short life still, because you've got a lot more, many, many years. You talk about your dad, you've got many more left in your journey. I just want you to know how grateful I am to you for leading your generation and speaking out. I think a lot of us are living in the wrong fear, and we are fearing man, we're fearing our own voices, and we're not ready to step out into what God has really called us to do. In your book, I know we could be here forever, and people are going to have to pick up their own copy of Redefined, Confronting the Labels That Limit Us. You have so much meat in your book. I love it. I was privileged to have an advanced copy of it, and I marked it up, and it's wonderful. But you start your book with the power of a word, and you end it with the power of a thought. In between, there are 10 labels, which I, you know, talked about earlier and went over. Which one do you still struggle with?
Ooh, wow, that's a great question. I'd say the one that I've struggled with the most recently has been discouragement. I think there's been a lot of things that 2020 brought that, you know, we tried to do that didn't end the way that we thought it would. And through that, I experienced a lot of discouragement. And I thank God that I have such an amazing wife, because my wife continued to remind me of the principles that I wrote about in this book, and continue to remind me of the principles of how faithful God is and not to worry about things in my own strength. And so that's been able to get me through. But I think, you know, that's the thing with discouragement is something that will continue to keep coming. And I think with a lot of these things, is it's not that the thing won't continue to come up. It's that you'll know how to combat them, and they will stop taking ground in your heart, like I talked about before. And so, you know, for me, I'm still navigating and still, you know, getting to that place where discouragement comes. It just kind of bounces right off me. But I know definitely, you know, for everyone, it was a hard year in 2020. And even with this book, like, I think for me, this book, I had to get to a point where I was like, God, I never thought I was going to write a book. So whatever happens with this, like, that's awesome. And this was never something that I wanted. You know, I never said when I was a kid I wanted to be an author. Even 2 years ago, I wanted to be an author. And so I've just been saying to myself, you know what, God, you told me to write this. If no one reads it, that's awesome. I just know that I was supposed to do this, and I did it. And so whatever happens with it, I'm giving it to you. So that would be the most recent one.
Well, you have one reader, because I read it.
Yeah, great. Hey, see, that's, well, I'm already doing better than I thought.
Exactly. There you go. All right. So what is your message? If you could sum it up, what is your message for your generation today?
I kind of going back to what I even said before is my message for our generation is that we'd be known as sons and daughters of God, that we would truly understand what God has given us, that we'd walk in that, and that future generations would look back and even, you know, before generations would look at us, and that they would say, you know, that generation is known as sons and daughters of God, that through everything that's going on, all the craziness in the world, all the disunity that is going on, that they would look back on us and they would just say that that generation is marked by God. And that's what I want to see from all the people here right now in this generation. And I want to see us just step into that, because I think we have everything that we need to be able to do that. You know, never before has a generation been able to impact the world through a simple post and reach someone across the world. And I think right now the enemy has tried to shift that, where we are using those things and those abilities to tear down and destroy and attack other people rather than to impact this world for his name. So
good. Sons and daughters. And I know people are going to want to connect with you. Tell us where they can find you and a little bit about Sons and Daughters.
Yeah. So the best thing to go to is actually there's a website called ardenbevere.com. On there, you'll be able to find the book. You'll be able to find actually some merch that we have with the book. You'll be able to find my social media. I'm getting better and better at social media, I will say. So I'm trying. I've never been someone that's big on tech and things like that. So my wife's helping me. So they'll be able to find all the information. They'll be able to get linked into sons and daughters, be able to find our podcast and everything.
Fabulous. Well, we will have all that information in the show notes, so it's readily available to the listeners. I know we could be here forever, but before I let you go, I have one final question. The series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story up until now gifted you?
My story has gifted me and I will say this from a place of just kind of navigating so much stuff, is I think, honestly, being humbled. Like I talked about, there was a lot of things that I thought I could do and a lot of things that I tried to do and did it in my own ability and fell right on my face. And I have been amazed to watch as I've leaned into what God's grace is on my life, that he's been able to do what I thought was absolutely impossible. I remember even recently when I had to read the book for the audiobook. As I said, I was in special needs reading and writing, and that was the scariest thing I thought I could do. I was like, this is going to be absolutely terrible. And I went in there and I struggled so much with reading it. And I mean, the guy was like, yeah, average time it takes to read a chapter is about 30 to 40 minutes. And I finished my first chapter in an hour and 40 minutes. And not only that, after we finished it, he said, hey, there was something wrong with the audio, and we had to redo it all over again. And I just was going into a dark place, and I was like, what is going on? And then I remember, I was like, I didn't pray. God, I didn't ask you to help me in this. And I said, I'm terrible at this. I'm like, I need your help at this. And I remember I just told him, I said, hey, guys, can we stop real quick? And I went to the bathroom and I just prayed. I said, God, I need your grace. I need you to speak through me on this book. And I went through, remember, I finished the next chapter in 25 minutes. And so I just watching what God does, it's something so beautiful and something I never can take credit for.
Amen. Well, God is definitely blessing your life. I know he's going to bless this book, and it's going to reach your generation and other generations too. Thank you so much for sharing your story, and I cannot wait to see what God has in store for you.
Thank you so much for having me on. It's truly been an honor.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.